我真的想别人给 test 哦。
你話
啲泥入去啦，嗰啲出俾人 cash 咗，跟住接尾啦。一開始就係咁樣。
All right. Anti-dumping, countervailing duties. The other duties, even though they are called duties, they are not have nothing to do with the regular duties that we see. They are not.Found in a HTS US number. They are determined not by customs. They are yet enforced by customs. And they made it into the customs world as we first saw it on the CBP form 7501 instructions, where when we were discussing the description of merchandise reporting requirement in the column or rather block 28, we found something such as this, the ADCVD case number. And A stands for anti, D stands for dumping, C stands for countervailing, D stands for duties. So you see AD, CV, sometimes you see them as to be referred to as ADD, CVD, and the last letter simply stands for duties, and this one stands for dumping, anti, countervailing duties. So this is basically the short form for customs examiners to ask you about this question. So when you see this, think about the buzzwords, right? Anti-dumping, countervailing. And they sneak up on you in various at various levels. And they customs examiners may test you on such topic as duty drawback. And one of their favorite questions is to say, well, duty drawback is when you get your duties back by exporting something out of the country after you import it. And customs examiners would like to ask, well, you brought something and you paid anti-dumping duties on it. And while it sounds like duties, duty drawback, duty here, duties here, it sounds like it is something which is one of the same, it is misleading. And why? That's one of the reasons I think customs like to ask about it is say, can you get duty drawback, meaning 99% of duties, or in case of a North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, 100%. And they sneak up on you, though this duties sneak up on you in duty drawback context, as can you pay so much money in anti-dumping, can you get them back? And the answer is, in the context of duty drawback, the answer is big no, because they are different type of animal. They are not duties as we think of them. So if they are not duties as we think of them, what are they? What kind of animal are anti-dumping duties? So this is subject of today's discussion. And if you have your outline, you can pull it out, or just follow me as we go through this on the board. Recently, customs they did test quite extensively on the topic of anti-dumping before, but I have noticed a trend, and the trend has a very basic reason for this. The trend is the number of testing has gone up. And customs examiners, when they ask you to bring your CFR material, Code of Federal Regulations, CFR, they say, well, it must be Title 19 from zero through the end. Not too long ago, it was from zero to 199. And the reason they start asking you through the end is it has to do with the context of anti-dumping. Those guys becoming more popular. Anti-dumping, countervailing duties became increasingly become the major instrument for United States government to control the flow of trade. They are very effective in the context of non-market economies such as China. They are much more easier to do than in the context of market economies. A non-market economy is simply the one of those terms of art. It's a political term. It doesn't mean, it really means a set of presumptions when you determine the rate that you should do. And that status gives you easier way to impose anti-dumping duties as opposed to the other countries, such as European countries. But European countries have anti-dumping duties too, such as Italian pasta. Everyone eats pasta? Well, if it comes from Italy, you must be mindful that it is subject to anti-dumping duties. Yeah? How do you know that? By looking at the harmonized tariff schedule alone, you will not know that. If you are filing entries on ABI, Automated Broker Interface, on a computer, usually the programs, they are designed to flag that, it's possible that it's subject to anti-dumping duties. And usually that's how you find out. But if you find out about the anti-dumping duty applicability of it, by the time you're hitting this, that means you have already stuff that are about to hit the border or already at the border. And what that means is that it's kind of too late. You needed to do the homework before. So really, as a licensed customs broker, what customs examiners expect you to know, of course, is this part, the end, which comes after 199. I believe it's from 200 until 360. And a majority of it comes from anti-dumping part, the part 351. So before even diving into this, let's talk about what this really is. How they come about? We know that duties, regular duties, you look at the harmonized tariff schedule and you see 3% or 5% or 16% or duty-free. And we know that they come from the harmonized tariff schedule. Harmonized tariff schedule is established by Congress. And this is the legitimacy of the duties. This is how you know how much you pay. Kind of like with Internal Revenue Service taxes. Congress establishes the rate, IRS makes the publication, and you pay the taxes pursuant to IRS interpretation of Congress. Same thing here. But in the context of anti-dumping, they really go back to way back, I think, to 1915, I believe, the early 20th century, and they, as the time went on, and the international trade became more integrated. To be honest, it was integrated before World War I, before 1914. It was very easy for you to order something through the catalog. If you are in London and order it from something like India or some African country and get it at your doorsteps, it was practiced. After the World War II, the international trade went down. And then there was a period of crisis. In the United States, there was a Great Depression, for example. There was a period when Smoot-Hawley Tariff Act was introduced, which brought the duties enormously high, like 50% for normal duties we're talking about. So during the 30s, there was this period when there was almost, it was very difficult to bring stuff into the country. Then there was World War II, And after World War II, this new order came about with advent of Bretton Woods system. Have anyone heard of Bretton Woods? Bretton Woods was it's a town, I believe, in England. And the system, world powers came in together, and they decided how they're going to establish the world after the defeat of Germany. So whatever, wherever we live right now is a commonly known post-Bretton Woods system, although it is much eroded. And Bretton Woods system established several things. One thing, it's unofficially established the dollarization of economy. This is why whenever you go to overseas, you are likely to see the dollar is accepted in many places. Imagine going here and, here in New York, you can find a lot of exchange rate places. But even if you try to go with the euro, I had a guy, I was talking to the gentleman near the bus stop in an airport, and he didn't have any dollars with him. He just came from Europe. He was trying to pay with euros. Euros are more expensive than a dollar, 1 euro to $1. And he was trying to give the bus driver the euro, saying, I don't have any dollars, can I please pay with this? He's like, no, I'm not accepting that. In many other countries, if you go and try to pay with a dollar, people will say, okay. Again, depends on the country, right? So the point being is, dollar is very much established here, but it was the beginning of establishment of dollarization of economy. In addition to that, unofficially, United States promised to back it with a gold standard, which lasted until 1971, meaning that not individuals, I think for individuals it went in 1930s, but until 1971, governments, countries, could bring dollars, which accumulated in its central banks, for example, to United States and say, give us some gold. Because officially, the legitimacy of the dollar was supported by gold. In 1965, Charles de Gaulle, anyone hear of Charles de Gaulle? He was a French president. And he said, those Americans, I don't trust them. So he showed up with, he came to America with his paper money and said, I don't trust this green paper. Give me some gold. And there was a lot of scandal. But eventually he left back with gold. And there is a famous speech, it's on Google, Charles de Gaulle gold speech. Put it on Google, you will see it, where he justifies this step as being a rational step. You could say because of French, you could say for many other reasons, it went to the gold. 1971, President Nixon was the president at the time. He said, we are no longer guaranteeing it with the gold. So now the paper money, the dollar, these dollar bills, are just good faith money. They are pretty much based on, let's leave it there. They're pretty much based on the fact that we trust US government, really it's a promise, nothing else. So this is huge. I think this was a huge establishment. But going back to customs and going back to anti-dumping, Bretton Woods system established something else. It established the system of GATT, or General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, GATT. And that was an agreement between countries based on the idea that after the World War, after the horrors, after so many deaths, it was based on the idea to say, look, we do not want to repeat the Treaty of Versailles. Anyone hear of Treaty of Versailles? After the World War I, 1917, 18, nations that defeated Germany, and it's subject to the debate to historians whether it was defeated or not, but they came together to in Versailles in France, and they said, we going to punish Germany for all the bad things that German people did to us. And they introduced what's called the reparations. And reparations were so harsh that German economy was suffering. In addition to that, again, subject to the historian argument, the German people, when they saw their German troops marching back in good condition, more or less, they felt like they were stabbed into the back. So they did not feel like they were defeated. Again, it's debatable, but it left within the German people kind of ill feeling that they were being let down, and there was some kind of bad misdeed that took place, which eventually, again, there are many arguments about how Hitler came to rise. It's subject to the debate in the years to come. But the fact is that Nazis came to power, and one of the reasons for them coming to power is or for their success is that type of ideal that we do not have to take this, right? And of course, we all know the history, the World War II was lost, but the memories were still ripe that we do not want to repeat this. So what we're going to do is we're not going to punish the country, we're going to integrate it. In other words, we're going to hug the world in our hands, and we're gonna try to be good friends.